Back on MorningLine, our final segment this morning with Metro Vice Mayor Jim Shulman talking about affairs in the city of Nashville beyond. We're kind of focused on COVID right now and the masks and the phase two, phase three, all this. A lot of people with strong opinions and questions on it. We've got next up is Linda. Linda, good morning. Hi, Linda.
Good morning. I know I called in yesterday with basically the same question for you, Nick, but yeah. I'd like to ask the Vice Mayor this.
Sure.
Who and what? How are we going to enforce or people who are going out of state, like to California and to Florida, and coming back and they're getting sick and no telling who all they are infecting? There's, is there a way or what are we going to need to do to get a 14-day isolation mandate for folks that fly out of our state?
That's interesting. We know that New York and New Jersey already have something like that in place. The governor has to put it in fact, if you're someone in New York and you come to Tennessee, okay, they've isolated Tennessee as a trouble spot. And if you fly back to New York, you will be required, and I'm not sure how they track you and all, to quarantine for 14 days after coming back from Tennessee. I don't know that our governor is going to take that step for travelers coming, but she makes a point. I mean, we can do everything right here, and if we have people coming from New York or Florida that are infected, that doesn't help much.
Right. So, Linda, if you're, I mean, it's not a city thing. It would be a state thing. You'd need to get in touch with the governor's office or your state representative, state senator, and push that idea that way. It's like Nick said, New York doing the same thing from people coming from Tennessee into New York. I'm not exactly sure how they deal with it or not. I don't know if they're waiting at the plane and then, they're saying you got to go into 14-day quarantine. So it has to go up to the state level to do that. Again, when she was talking about it, I was thinking at some point, if it gets bad enough, other states may start doing the same thing and just saying, you can't come here. You can't come here from this state because, you have the possibility of being infected. A lot of this, again, is personal responsibility and people stepping up and doing what they're supposed to. So, most people don't travel right now. You're not sure where you're going to end up staying. If you do travel, you take those precautions, you be very careful. And if you've been around somebody that may be infected, or if you are infected, or if you go get tested and you're infected, you gotta lock down. But Linda's thinking through it. You see other states doing it. We're not doing it here, but it's obviously at least an option because other states are doing it as well.
Let's go next to, I think we've got Constance. Hi, Constance.
Hi.
Hi, what's on your mind?
I've read the letter from CoreCivic CEO Henninger about their intent to apparently walk away from the facility here in Nashville in 90 days. I know the sheriff has done some work on it and said that if we had the proper transition time in Metro, that the sheriff's office could assume responsibility, the idea of proper transition being 2 years. We're already in the middle of a pandemic, and now CCA says they're going to walk away. It will be a huge burden for Metro, and I'm wondering what, if anything, Metro government can do to support the sheriff's office in trying to assume responsibility for this facility.
Okay. I'm really glad. That'll probably take us up to the end of the show, so give us an answer on this, because several people have messaged on Facebook as well. What does this mean? And man, she paints a picture there that's kind of, a concern. But I assume the mayor and the sheriff are going to get together on this.
Well, yeah, they have to. So there's a bill floating tonight on second reading with the Metro Council. We start at 6:30. That bill was in front of the Budget Committee yesterday, and it was deferred indefinitely. Okay, so the bill was to say at a certain time we're not going to have contracts with private prison companies to operate prisons in Davidson County. That letter came in yesterday afternoon, right before the Budget Committee, and I think it obviously, if you listen to the meeting, people were taking a step back and going, "Wait, whoa, whoa, we got to figure out what's going on." So I talked to the sheriff last night. I think there is going to have to be very quick conversations and serious conversations with CoreCivic, with the mayor's office, with the sheriff, involving the council at some point. I think the sheriff had at some point said at some point if the people wanted to do this and move it over to the sheriff's office, there would have to be a transition, that we're still trying to figure out what that cost would be, what the cost would be to taxpayers, all those different things. But you can't do it in 3 months. So now we got a situation going on. This is where leadership steps up. This is where we all sit down at the table, cool heads prevail, and we try to figure out what to do.
It's interesting though, because that letter, and she read it and I've read it, I mean, it seems like that CEO at CoreCivic is not happy, and that was a fairly terse letter. And so to sit down, it sounds like they're out in 90 days, and not much you're going to say is going to change
that. Well, so this is where we have to quickly, because Constance is right. I mean, the sheriff said we could do it if he had the proper time for transitioning. We don't have the proper time for transitioning, so we got to figure out what to do at this point. Letter just came in yesterday. Yeah, I think probably an understatement would be that he was not happy. I mean, I think he was very unhappy. We saw the letter. You can see it out there. We now have to respond and we have to act.
Do you know how much that CoreCivic contract is worth?
Do not know. I was looking at a lot of the information yesterday. I'm just not sure what it is.
Would it be in the millions of dollars?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. It's a
big contract.
Daily reimbursement per prisoner, I think, from the state. But there's some other things that are involved in this, Nick, and this is what the sheriff was talking about, was that transition over from if we were to switch from CoreCivic to the sheriff running the facility, what does it cost to switch that over? Because a lot of that money comes in from the state, but we might have some funding that's needed from Metro, and people are mad at us for, you know, the 34% property tax increase, and now we may have an additional cost. This is where we have to step up. You need to pay attention to what's going on. It needs to be transparent. There needs to be discussions very, very quickly about what that letter meant and whether we can get everybody kind of back in. Because this is a safety issue.
And at its core, we just have 10 seconds, but at its core, it's going to be, what the heck are we going to do with all these inmates that CoreCivic's handling?
Right.
Those inmates, that's where it comes down. When they're gone, you just can't leave the inmates alone. So, hey, we'll talk more on this. And Vice Mayor, thank you for coming on.
Sure.
We'll talk to you again next week, all right?
Okay, sounds good.
Take a break. Be back with the programming note right after this.